If not, we retain up to 15 minutes for rebuttal. If you're the appellant and you wish to reserve that time, please let me know when you come up to the podium and keep in track of the clock and we'll keep your flags in place of time. We are being visually and audibly recorded. We are, yes, we are. So please try to remain behind the podium as much as possible. We have heard your briefs and we're ready to continue.
Good morning, Your Honors. My name is Andrew Whitaker. I represent Mr. Duffield in this matter. I'm here on behalf of him today. I would like to reserve 5 minutes for rebuttal. First of all, I appreciate the opportunity to be here and the opportunity to participate in this court's Courtroom in the Classroom Educational Outreach Program. On December 3rd, 2016, David Duffield attempted to evade capture by the Akron Police Department. That is what he was doing that day. They were trying to arrest him pursuant to an arrest warrant from another county, and Mr. Duffield's sole motivation that day was to evade capture. 45 minutes they spent chasing Mr. Duffield throughout the neighborhoods they were in. At one point, he found himself hiding, crouched down so nobody could see him in the front seat of a car. That's what he did. 45 minutes was attempt to evade the Akron Police Department. He was eventually captured after being shot by Officer Kennedy 3 times, and he was convicted of felonious assault, which was a first degree felony because it involved the officer as the victim, obstruction of official business, and grand theft. The charges of grand theft and obstruction were not appealed, so they're not before this court today. I'd like to begin, with Your Honor's permission, with a discussion of Mr. Duffield's third assignment of error, which was the trial court's denial of his request for the jury instruction of attempted reckless assault. Attempted reckless assault was requested by the defendant's attorney before the matter went to the jury, and that was denied. As the court knows, if a charge is both supported by law and by fact and requested properly and at the appropriate time, the law requires that that charge be given to the jury in the instructions. Both the court and the state here as the appellee have argued that the charge requested by Mr. Duffield was not proper because of the mens rea issues. So Mr. Duffield's requested instruction was attempted reckless assault. So it involves kind of the juxtaposition of two separate mens reas. And what the trial court said and what state is saying here before this court is that you cannot have an attempt of a statute that only requires a reckless mens rea or a negligent mens rea. In other words, the request for the reckless assault would require the jury to find a reckless mens rea. And the attempt statute itself, which is 29-2302A, actually contains itself a knowing component of it. So what the trial court said is that it's impossible to have an attempt of a statute that requires recklessness or negligence as an element. And Mr. Duffield argues today that that is an inaccurate statement of the law. It is inaccurate both, we know, by common sense. You can know you're doing something that is reckless. You can know you're doing something that is negligent. You know that you're engaging in this conduct. That doesn't change that the conduct itself is negligent or reckless. That the conduct itself is negligent to a potential harm, or acting with reckless indifference to a potential harm.
Counsel, I know that the jury instruction request is not for negligence.
No.
But by virtue of your argument, would you then extend that argument to say that you could have an attempted offense that had a negligent mens rea?
I would, Your Honor. Mr. Duffield did actually request an attempted negligent assault. Mr. Duffield did not believe that that was necessarily supported by the facts, so we did not appeal the refusal for that excuse. we only appeal the refusal for the reckless, because that seemed to be, as always is important with the jury instruction request, what was supported by the facts. But I do believe that the law does allow, if the facts fit the situation, for an attempted negligent. And I think that, again, besides being supported by just a common sense thinking of how that would play out, it also is very clearly supported in the comment section of the attempt statute, which reads that under this section, and this is the comments to the attempt statute, under this section, an attempt must be purposely or knowingly committed. If the offense attempted specifies, so we're talking again about the statute that you are looking to attack the attempt to, if that statute specifies that the culpable mens rea is purposeful, then the attempt must be purposeful. But purposeful and knowing for attempting is sufficient to make the attempt an offense if the crime specified provides a mens rea of purposeful, knowing, reckless, or negligent. In other words, the comments embrace the fact that the attempt can be and is contemplated to be added to crimes that involve a purposeful, a knowing, a negligent, or a reckless, as cases here, I believe, mens rea. So it is not only, I believe, possible by just thinking about how it would flow, it actually is very specifically embraced by the statute and the legislative history that we have here. So the second question that a court must address when deciding whether or not this instruction was legitimately requested and should have been given to the jury after this attempt issue, which is where the court and the state's analysis ended, is of course whether or not the reckless assault is a lesser included or an inferior degree of the felonious assault here. And while the trial court did not address that issue because it denied it based on the initial analysis of the mens rea, I do believe here that the reckless assault requested is both an inferior and a lesser degree of the felonious assault. We have the same elements with the additional mitigating knowing element of the mens rea.
Lesser or inferior?
Well,
different concepts.
They are two different concepts, and something I learned very much about while briefing this case. I do believe it actually fits both, because I believe that it is a lesser included, because all of the elements are included in reckless assault that are in felonious assault. So by definition, well, by definition, I believe the reckless is included in a knowing mental state. So although it's a different one, because it's a lesser, it includes it with it. So I do believe it is a lesser included, but I also believe that it very clearly fits into the inferior degree, because it is the same elements with the additional mitigating of the reckless mens rea. So I think this is one of the more unique cases where it fits both. It may be more on all fours with the inferior, but I do believe it also can apply to the lesser included. Yeah, the court has no more questions about the third assignment of error. I'll just briefly address first and second assignment of error. Before I move on, I'm sorry, I did just want to note that I do believe that then the final part of the analysis is whether or not the facts of this case supported such a request. If this court determines that it was lawfully allowed, if that is a proper instruction, whether or not the facts of Mr. Duffield's conduct fit that he acted with heedless indifference to the consequences and disregarded a substantial and unjustifiable risk. And I think that that describes Mr. Duffield's conduct that day perfectly. He backed up on a one-way street. Of course, you can see from the exhibits, I believe it's exhibit 3 that shows he only had one way to go. He backed up in the continuation of his 45-minute attempt to flee capture. And Officer Kennedy was crossing at a diagonal to try to stop him, and Mr. Duffield reckless mens rea. So I believe it was also supported by the facts of this case. And that, I guess, leads pretty clearly into our first and second assignment of error, and that is that the evidence at trial did not support the conviction of a knowing felonious assault, but instead the only thing that the state was able to present to the jury was evidence of reckless. So therefore, the evidence produced at the trial was both insufficient and against, and the verdict was against the manifest weight of the evidence. Because what the jury was told and what the witnesses testified to was that, again, Mr. Duffield was attempting to evade capture and ran for 45 minutes, he hid in the car, all he wanted to do was get out of there. As soon as he saw, as he was running, and the facts of the case explained in both of the briefs, that he was running for two homes when they finally caught up with him again, and he saw the unattended police vehicle, ran across the street, hopped into it, put it in reverse, and an attempt to get out of there. And so I believe that the evidence supports the fact that a knowing mens rea was not proven to the jury. And I'll just briefly say that even Officer Kennedy's testimony was that he was in constant motion when he was approaching the vehicle that Mr. Duffield was in. He was crossing the street. So he wasn't in a stationary position that Mr. Duffield went for. Mr. Duffield went straight back. Officer Kennedy was moving at the time. And I believe that is why there was insufficient evidence and it was against the manifest weight of the evidence to have a conviction for felonious assault. Thank you.
To the appellant's third assignment of error, the state would argue that this is not a lesser included offense and that the trial court did not err in declining to give a jury instruction based on the law as well as the facts of this case. With regard to the elements being the same, the state would argue that they are not, because reckless assault is completed when you recklessly cause serious physical harm as opposed to felonious assault in this case, which was knowingly attempting to cause serious physical harm with a deadly weapon. So here you have intent to cause serious physical harm, and you have the mens rea of knowing. With regard to the comments and the statute for attempt, it does discuss the fact that if you act purposely, then if an element is required for a lower mens rea, that's included, and that's because in Ohio and many states, the mens rea is on a continuum. Obviously, if you act purposely, if something requires something less than that, than purposeful, they're all included. But that does not mean that if you commit a knowing assault versus a reckless assault, that that's what that comment meant. It's just discussing the fact that there's a continuum of mens rea. Clearly, when you look at the assault statute, we have a number of different assaults. They have all different elements. Felonious assault is clearly not meant to have reckless assault as a lesser included. It's illogical to say that you can knowingly act recklessly or negligently. If you're acting recklessly, then you're acting recklessly. Once you know that you're doing it, you're no longer acting recklessly or negligently. You moved up that continuum, and now you're acting knowingly. So it doesn't fit at all. And even without having to answer that question, this court doesn't even have to get to a legal, definitive, bright-line rule on that, because the facts do not support a reckless assault in this case. These officers were chasing Mr. Duffield for 45 minutes. He did hide in the vehicle. He went through a number of attempts to evade the police. But once he made eye contact with Officer Kennedy, and Officer Kennedy told him to get on the ground, and Mr. Duffield made the decision to look at Officer Kennedy, to ignore his instructions, to jump into that police cruiser and put it in reverse and head right at Officer Kennedy, that went from evading, eluding, avoiding apprehension to knowingly attempting to cause serious physical harm to that officer. The officer testified that he had had moved to it and hit. An eyewitness testified that if Officer Kennedy hadn't jumped out of the way, he would have been hit. So it was much, much more than just evading the police at that point. Clearly, he wanted to get away, but you can't just say everything I do trying to get away is just evasion. It's clearly moved into it, knowing I tapped at that officer.
There is
some video tape.
And when does that tape begin? After he has back up the cruiser, or what is the postmark that they show?
I believe it started before he backed up the cruiser. I believe. And I would put the console right on. I believe it happened. I believe that it started before he backed up the cruiser. But the fact is that he was aiming it at that officer. Once he realized he was boxed in, he couldn't get anywhere but heading at the officer, then you're caught. You can't just aim at your vehicle, that was stolen vehicle at that point, a police cruiser, at the officer and say, well, I didn't mean to cause you any harm, I was just trying to get away.
When he went to back up the vehicle, the officer was behind the vehicle.
Behind and to the side, and there'll be a dispute about the facts as to whether it's directly behind or not. That's why we had to look at the CSU testimony with regard to the bullets, where they were. CSU forensic person testified that one bullet definitely of the 10 was from behind and one was from the side, but that's the heart of the dispute, is exactly where was the officer. But there is no reason to believe that the officer's testimony wasn't credible. There's also an eyewitness who testifies, corroborates Officer Kennedy's statement that he had to get out of the way or this vehicle would have hit him. So the evidence does not support that Mr. Duffield's actions on that day were reckless. The evidence supports that they were knowing and that he was doing more than just trying to get out of the situation.
He's parked in a dead end, correct? Mm-hmm. Well, the car is parked.
The car is
a cruiser, and Mr. Duffield helps himself to the police cruiser. And he can't do a U-turn, so he's going out backwards, correct?
Right.
Isn't trying to get out of there at all costs, no matter who or what is behind him, isn't that recklessness?
I think it's more than reckless, though.
What makes it more than reckless?
The fact that there's somebody behind you, and there's an officer behind you. And I think it's more than reckless to make a decision when you see an officer and he tells you to get down, that instead of getting down, you go get in their cruiser. That has to be more than reckless, to get into a police cruiser.
That's a smart.
Mm-hmm. And then take that cruiser, though, and then go in the direction where the officer's at. That's more than reckless. I mean, to say that that conduct is reckless, it's just so making light, I think, of the danger that that officer was in, the danger that any civilian would have been in. It's, we may look at it and say that's, who would do something like that? That's at the very least reckless, but I think it's
say that if you haven't seen the officer, haven't had any contact with the officer at all, jumping in front of the worst bad here?
Sure, but when you know where the officer is and you get in his vehicle and you head in his direction, I think that shows that you're knowingly trying to cause that harm in your effort to get away. If there was no one there, he just found the cruiser, hopped in, backed out, got away, the officers hadn't instructed him to stop, then sure. We would have almost an impossible time to show that he's trying to actually purposely or knowingly cause a terrible harm. But here, once he's caught, he's ordered to get down, he gets in the cruiser, he aims at the officer, I don't see how he can make that argument that he was just reckless. I don't think that it fits factually. And with regard to the sufficiency and the weight of the evidence to support the felonious assault, they basically intertwined with that third assignment there with the jury instruction, but the elements are that he knowingly caused or attempted to cause serious physical harm. The state would argue that based on the facts as articulated by the appellant and also by the appellee, what shown in the record is that the officer made eye contact with Mr. Duffield with the gun drawn, told him to get to the ground. Duffield ran to the cruiser, got in, headed towards the cruiser. At least two of those shots were fired either from the side or behind the cruiser by Officer Kennedy. And Mr. Duffield only came to stop when he was struck chase was contacted by officer by no one leaving that vehicle in reverse, knowing where the officer was after being pulled.
So do they make any difference in a police cruiser?
I don't think so. I think it probably goes a little bit towards the element of knowingly, but I don't think it ultimately makes a difference as far as so that you see the cruiser come into view of it, but it's after it's passed Officer Kennedy. So while it was played with the jury and there was much discussion about it, it was not particularly helpful in terms of determining the relationship between Officer Kennedy and the vehicle. And neither was the state's expert. The FLE has indicated that the state's expert, in terms of the ballistic trajectory, supports its position here. And the state's expert specifically testified that there was no way to know from his analysis where Officer Kennedy was standing in relationship to the vehicle. So while you could say, talk about a little bit about where the bullets went in and how they hit Mr. Duffield, that he testified that his testimony cannot be relied upon to determine where Officer Kennedy was when he shot. And that was his scientific evidence as an expert certified in this case. I think that the argument by the FLE actually helps to demonstrate the court's question about why isn't this just reckless. He begins on the sidewalk, then he's in the street. He is in a constant state of motion from the minute Mr. Duffield gets into the vehicle until Mr. Duffield stops because he's been shot. So he's not at a fixed point, and Mr. Duffield is gunning it towards him. Mr. Duffield gets in the car, and he's on the sidewalk. Then he's behind him. Then he's beside him. There were a total of 10 shots that were fired by Officer Kennedy. 3 hit Mr. Duffield. And as the FLE said, they believe that at least one shot was from behind, and one shot was from the side. So it is further support for the fact that the conduct here was reckless. The conduct described by Emma Lee, that if Officer and Mr. Duffield had just found the car, backed up to get out of there and left, that's not even reckless, that's negligent. Just to steal a car there's no reckless conduct there. The reckless conduct is to know that there are people around you and to act in heedless indifference to the potential danger to those people. That is what reckless is. And it fits perfectly in this situation. You know there's individuals around you. Still gunning the car with heedless indifference to the danger you are putting them in. That is what reckless is, and that is clearly what Mr. Duffield exhibited that day. In terms of the discussion on the lesser included, and that somehow the comments really only go to the issue of purposeful and everything else is included, and that, of course, mens rea is on a continuum. In fact, what the statute, the comments specifically say is you can knowingly attempt to commit a crime whose mens rea is negligent or reckless. That is, the law recognizes that possibility exists. You know you're acting in doing this conduct that is going to have, is reckless to the danger to the people around you. The attempt statute specifically allows that knowing to apply to the attempt, but the mens rea for the underlying offense to continue to be reckless or negligent. Thank you, Your Honors.
Thank you both for your presentations today. The court will take the matter under advisement, issue a written decision, which will be.